So hello everyone and welcome to the Prayer Pod, our weekly podcast from pray.com.au, service of the Australian Jesuits. Today I'm privileged to talk to Gemma Sissia, the founder of the School of St. Jude, and Doris, who is one of the first graduates of the School of St. Jude in Tanzania. Now, thank you so much to both of you for speaking to us today. Doris, welcome to Australia.
Thank you.
Your first time in Australia, how are you enjoying your time here?
Yes, it's my first time in Australia and I'm so happy. I'm having a good time here.
That's great. Now, where have you travelled so far in Australia?
We've been in so many places, Sydney, Melbourne, Canberra, Wagga Wagga, Echuca, and so many other places I can't remember them all.
Fabulous. Okay. So, Gemma, you are a girl from Armidale, the Armidale Diocese. So you grew up on a farm. I'm not sure how far outside of Armidale it is, but you grew up on a farm with lots of brothers and did an education science degree, and then were educated at St. Vincent's in Potts Point and went over to Uganda, I believe, to volunteer after you'd finished uni, and basically never came back. So maybe tell us a little bit about the whole experience, why it was that you went to Africa in the first place and how it is that you came to found the School of St. Jude. It's a very loaded question.
Yeah. Okay, so so I was born in Armidale Hospital in northern New South Wales, and I was brought up on a farm about 80 kilometres north of Armidale. I went to school in Sydney, so that's where I finished my HSC at St. Vincent's College in Sydney, and then I went to Melbourne University and lived at Newman College, which is run by the Jesuits, and had a wonderful time. But it was whilst I was at Newman and I met a wonderful nun, Sister Kay, one time at church, and she had just come back from Africa, sadly for cancer treatment, but she was telling me lots and lots about a school that she was running and had been running for many, many years, and how she was in need of some math science teachers. At the time, I was teaching science at university. I mean, I was learning science at university or doing science. And so I decided to do a diploma in education back in Armidale and go and work at Sister K School in Uganda. So that's how I got to go to Uganda.
Fabulous. Mm-hmm. Now, it was while you were in Uganda that you went on safari. And you write about this in your book, St. Jude's School. And you went on safari, and something happened while you were on safari that changed the course of your life. You were thinking at the time about becoming a nun, I believe, and you met an interesting person on safari.
Yes, I was. By that time I was in my mid-20s, and I went on safari because everyone who goes to East Africa has to go and see the Serengeti or Ngorongoro Crater and all the national parks that you see on all the wildlife channels. So I went on safari, and really weird, I fell in love with the driver.
As you do.
Yes, you know, if someone had told me that I was going to fall in love with someone in Africa, I would have told them to go back to the pub. You know, but it's amazing, you know, God has these sort of plans for you. But anyway, we didn't marry till about 8 years after we first met. But yes, I married Richard, my safari driver.
Lovely. And you now have five children,
I believe?
Four. Oh, sorry.
That's okay.
Sorry, why did I think five? I'm not sure why I thought five.
That's okay. Four children, so two boys and two girls.
Okay.
And amazingly, I was wanting to build a school.
Yes.
And when I married Richard, I got the best father-in-law in the bargain. And my father-in-law gave me a couple of acres of land. It turned out that my father-in-law was a village chairman, was very pro-education. So I was given a piece of land to start the school that I wanted to build. And that's how it started. Call it fate. I don't call it fate. I call it faith. And someone up in heaven, I think, you know, a couple of my grandmothers are helping. Or St. Jude. And that's why I call the school St. Jude.
Now, St. Jude is the patron saint of hopeless causes. Is that right?
So when I wanted to start this school, you know, so I came back from Africa after working at this school, from Sister K School, all fired up about wanting to build a private school, but one that was free of charge. So I came back home all fired up about wanting to build this school, and told my parents and my brothers and everyone I knew, and I'm sure you can imagine how that went down. You know, lots of, well, you know, darling, I wanted to do things like that when I was your age. You know, that's a great idea, but how about you maybe just sit on the idea for about 6 months and get a job in the meantime? And these sorts of questions and statements. But anyway, so a good friend of mine, her name is Agnes, and in Armidale, and she said, Gemma, I think your school idea is a great idea. So she gave me my first $10, and that was enough for me to open a bank account, and it was enough to start the fundraising for the school. And I called the school St. Jude, because St. Jude, yes, is known as the patron saint of the hopeless cases, but he's also privately my best friend. And I thought, well, trying to start a school is, you know, with $10 is pretty hopeless. So that's why
it's got to start somewhere.
That's right. Yeah, so that's why I called the school after St. Jude.
Great. Now, Doris, you are one of the first students or first graduating students of St. Jude. St. Jude's School. Tell us a little bit about your experience of attending the school.
For me, I went to the public schools for my primary education, and after finishing my standard 7, my primary, I got a letter from the School of St. Jude inviting me to compete for the scholarship. So we went through some stages and I passed all of them, and in 2009 I started my studies at the School of St. Jude. It was such a good and amazing environment for me, because we had, you know, comfortable classes, we had enough teachers, we had all the exercise books and textbooks, we had computers, we had internet, we had good breakfast, lunches and dinner. Yeah, so in short, we had everything that a student deserve. So it was a very good environment for me.
Fair enough. And tell me a little bit about your family. How is it that you grew up, and why is it that it was such a privilege to go to St. Jude's School?
For me, we are five at home. I have two brothers and two sisters, and my parents didn't get the chance to go to secondary school, so they just ended in primary, and so they don't have these good jobs like teachers or any. So instead we have a small garden at home, and my dad always grow different things like carrots, tomatoes and other crops, and also we have chicken at home. We sell them, we get money for living.
Oh, okay. Fabulous. And what is your hope now that you've finished school at St. Jude's? What's your plan? Would you like to study more?
Yeah, we finished this school last year, and currently we're doing a gap year.
That's right.
Community,
okay.
Service.
Yep.
We are volunteering to teach in some of the government schools. So currently I'm a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
And this September I'll be starting my university, a medical school.
Okay.
I'll be studying medicine because I want to become a doctor.
Fabulous. That's very exciting. And you plan to stay in Tanzania?
Yes, I plan to study in Tanzania and stay in Tanzania.
Okay, lovely. That's fabulous. So, Gemma, what stage is the school at now? I mean, it's grown exponentially. You started with, what, two students, I think, back in the early 2000s?
2002. We started,
yep,
just with a few students.
Mm-hmm.
And with all the help of people talking about the school and, you know, running events for us and telling their friends about the school, we've grown from three students to almost 2,000 now.
Mm-hmm.
And Doris's year were the year that we started the school with.
Mm-hmm.
So they finally reached year 12 last year.
Okay.
So we go now from grade 1 to grade 12. And at the end of year 12, because of the huge shortage of teachers in the public system in our area, the students have a gap type year where they use the skills that they were lucky enough to get at St. Jude's in the local school. So they all work as teachers,
yep,
for a year, and then they start the university studies.
Okay, fabulous. Now, St. Jude's has a very particular way of finding students to study at the school. So it's obviously a very popular school. Lots of people want to go to the school. But what are some of the conditions to go to St. Jude's School?
So basically, we have a scholarship program. And each student, like Doris, has a sponsor. So Doris gets to come to the school free of charge because her sponsor is paying her school fees for her. Now, because it's a private school and it's free of charge, you know, a lot of people want to come to it. You could imagine any private school here in Australia, if it was free of charge, they, you know, a lot of applications would come in. So we have a scholarship program, and like with any scholarship program, it could be a music scholarship or a dance scholarship or a sports scholarship. But the School St. Jude, they are academic scholarships, because we have visited over 50 universities in Africa, and they all recruit, sadly, on marks. It doesn't matter whether you're the school captain or the head prefect or the captain of the debating team or the footy team, if you want to get into medicine or engineering, you need those top marks in science and maths, sadly. And we really need professionals. You know, I had my four kids in Tanzania in the local hospital, and I can tell you from a personal experience, we desperately need doctors. And so that's what the School St. Jude wants to help with producing, is professionals to help take the country forward. So for about 6 months each year, we hang signs up around the district to say that the School St. Jude is full. However, around August each year, we pull those signs down and we put up other signs to say that there are vacancies available. If you would like to come and try for an entrance test, you're welcome to come any Saturday between August and December. Each week we would get in excess of 1,000 kids coming in to have a go at the entrance tests. And they have to do entrance tests, poverty checks, mean tests. Oh my gosh, there's so many stages. But to give you an example, a few months ago we enrolled 67 students into our grade 1 year. We take students into grade 1, or like with Doris's case, she came in at form 1. And however, those 67 scholarships, we had over 7,000 students apply. So it's very competitive to get a scholarship. But the kids appreciate the scholarship. They understand that there are sponsors here in Australia. Most of our funding is Australian, who are working very hard for them to get a good education and to use those skills for their community.
Fair enough. Now, each year, or almost each year, you come back here. Have you ever brought your kids back?
So once a year.
Yep.
Yeah, I come back to reconnect with people who are supporting the school,
mm-hmm.
because our main operation is in Africa. We yes. don't have a main office here in Australia.
Sure.
So once a year, we come back to Australia, and that really is a work trip for myself. But about every 3 years, my husband Richard and I bring back the kids for a family trip. So we go up to the farm and, you know, and sometimes we might go, I don't know, the beach or up to Brisbane where you're going to SeaWorld or...
Fabulous.
So at the end of the trip, Doris is going to be taken to SeaWorld with some of our sponsors on the Gold Coast.
Oh, lovely.
So we do that about every 3 years as a family.
Sounds great. Mm. And tell me how... How is family life in Tanzania for you and Richard and the four kids?
It's mad and busy, like, you know, with all families. So Richard and I are both working. The kids are in school. So, you know, like with any family, you've got to juggle work and family, you know, different pickup times, extracurricular sports and subjects, events happening. It's... you know, normal chaos, but I wouldn't have it any other way.
Sounds good. Any moments of doubt, any moments where you think, oh gosh, I don't want to do this anymore?
5 times a day?
Yep.
Okay. Every day.
It's good. And what keeps you going?
Students like Doris.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we've been on the road now for 2 weeks. Yesterday we had 6 presentations, and I'm, you know, I cried in 2 of them, and you'd think that I'd be used to it by now. But I, you know, it's wonderful to see someone who can now speak in English. It's wonderful to see someone who can answer questions on her feet. She spoke to 600 Rotarians the other day with such confidence. That's what makes it worth it.
Absolutely. Now, Doris, your first language is Swahili. Could you say something to us in Swahili? Maybe, hello, how are you? Teach our listeners how to say something in Swahili.
Mambo. Habari yako.
Really? That's beautiful. And Gemma, you speak Swahili as well?
Enough to get around.
Yeah.
I'm laughing because I'm not very good at it. But, you know, enough to get around and be understood, and I can understand most of conversations. But I'm also really lazy.
And what would be your hopes for the future of the School of St. Jude? What for both of you, what would be your hopes? Yeah.
My hope is that the children, you know, continue to study hard and work hard and appreciate the scholarships that they've been given. My hope is to have, a stronger structure in the school of Tanzanian leadership. We've always been trying to localise as many positions. So if you visited the school 10 years ago, you would have seen a lot of Western teachers, but now all our teaching staff are Tanzanian, headmasters are Tanzanian. We've still got about 15 positions in the school to localise, so gradually localising. And, you know, my dream is to see our students going off to university or whatever profession, be it trades, college, starting their own businesses and be a success. And I would love it if when my daughters have their babies, they go to Dr. Doris.
Absolutely. Well, Doris, did you have any final words that you'd like to say?
Yes, my final word is just to say thanks to all Australians for supporting the school, believing in Gemma's mission of fighting poverty in Africa. So I'd like to say thanks to everyone who's supporting the school.
Well, thank you to both of you.